Achtung. Time. Hello. Hello. Thank you. I can't offer you free pizza, so definitely Angus has me beat in that particular realm. But what we can go over is some juicy tidbits of operating systems. And there's still some conversations going on. Danke. Thank you. Still some conversations going on. Thank you. Okay. Again, what I'd like to do today is go over a little bit about review of what we talked about in the last session in terms of we've got the CPU thingamabob and threads and how we can kind of coordinate between the two. And the balance of the class is going to kind of tip into a little bit about how we can actually handle scheduling, threading, and processes in the context of modern operating systems on this. So questions before we actually begin from either last class, Monday's class, what have you? Talked about multiplexing, we talked about threads, we talked about interrupts, we talked about syscalls. Going once, going twice, everything clear as crystal. Alrighty. General questions, again, I can't get into details for obvious reasons right now, but questions about what's coming up, obviously. Checkpoint 2.1 is due at 5 p.m. If you're here today, I assume that is probably a pretty good sign on that. So we do have office hours after class right through the deadline itself. So if you're still kind of pounding away, you can certainly make use of that too. But again, just a reminder on that, checkpoint 2.1. And then just to reiterate, obviously the balance of assignment 2 is going to be due in 3 weeks. One small announcement about that. I know we've been kind of hitting you with a couple deadlines. Unfortunately, watch it with the balance of assignment number 2. It is a big one. This was honestly only a small part to kind of kickstart everyone on this. I would definitely not wait until Monday or, if you will, next week before you start looking at the rest of the class. As a matter of fact, I got asked the question, what's kind of a good time checkpoint and where, in terms of where we should be? Ideally, assuming that you're completing console tests today, if you could have, if you will, most of the file stuff wrapped up and pass the file-only test, which basically means read, write, open, close, and lseek. Maybe not all of the file functionality, but at least the basic stuff, if you can pass file-only tests by early to middle of next week. The reason I mention that is the balance of the project, which is the process control syscalls like fork, wait, PID, exec, those are big ones, okay? They are much more difficult and they're gonna take considerably more time than the file ones. So you don't wanna kind of divide it up 2 weeks and 2 weeks because you're gonna be shortchanging yourself on the other end. Plus, I'm sure, I know you have these things called other classes, how about that? And most professors, everyone has this bright idea about scheduling midterms either right before spring break or after spring break on this. I know Jeff has scheduled your midterm right after spring break, but the thing is, you probably do have, most of you, at least one test before spring break, so that's also going to be interfering with your completion of, if you will, assignment 2. So again, another reason, to the extent that you can kind of work ahead, I'll try to post some suggested timelines on Discourse on that, but again, an initial checkpoint to hit after this one would be kind of early to middle of next week if you can have file-only test passing. If you do not have it passing by that point in time, speak to the staff about exactly where you are, what we can do to kind of get you back on track. So just a short FYI about that. Questions about that stuff? Alrighty. All right. Transition between threads is, there we are. There we go. Context switch. Okay, another, what's a thread again, and what's a process again, and how does this kind of all wrap up? Well, we've got this CPU thingamabob that is being chased by a lot of these, if you will, programs that we're trying to run. And simply put again, a thread, think of it as an execution context. It's kind of where one particular processor is running one particular thing at a point in time, and then at another point in time, it runs another thing, if you will, to be really technical about that. So, and how do we switch from one thing to another thing, all right? That is what we call a context switch, to go from one thread to another. And again, the mechanism that we use to kind of enforce switching from one thread to the other is what? We talked about that. How do you get into the kernel? With a syscall, Well, it could be a syscall, okay, but if the syscall fails, we know there's going to be one type of interrupt, and that's a what type of interrupt? Timer. Exactly right. So again, clear on the distinction between a context switch and an interrupt. Roughly put, a interrupt is any sort of method to get into the kernel, and then once we're in the kernel, we're going to be running a scheduler, more on schedules in subsequent weeks. That's subject for PhD dissertations on this, okay? But then once we pick a thread to run, we now want to do a context switch in the kernel from one to another. That's where we go from one thing to the next thing. All right, CPU limitations. Remember, it's kind of a little bit weird here because what is it here? There's only one, and again, as odd as it sounds, being faster can be a bit of a limitation. It's good because we can run lots of stuff, but again, what's the problem with having a CPU that's much faster than the rest of the system? Races ahead, and then what does it do? Exactly, it twiddles its silicon thumbs on this. Okay, so remember we talked earlier about batch scheduling, and this is kind of the old model of computing. Before we had modern operating systems, we often had to wait. In other words, let's say programmer A walked in with a stack of punch cards, ran, let's say, some insurance processing job, and let's say while the job is running, all right, the CPU is finished with calculations and is waiting for something from the disk drive, and it waits, and waits, and waits. I quote Casablanca on that. So the upshot is, at this point, we only have one thing to run, so it's going to, if you will, result in a lot of inefficiencies, and that means money down the drain. All right, so instead what we do, there we go, okay. So instead of having just one thing, what we're gonna do is run a bunch of things here. And how we can actually do that again is with respect to an interrupt. And if an interrupt is not forthcoming vis-a-vis, let's say, a syscall, one way we can always make sure that the kernel will eventually get control is with a periodic timer tick on this. Again, I think I did mention in the last class, there are, roughly speaking, kind of two types of clocks. There's a periodic timer that's always running in the background, and you people as programmers are very often going to kind of set your own timers on that. We're not talking about that one. We're talking about the one that, if you will, the system is always running in the background to make sure we very often preempt into the kernel. All right, there we are. One other thing too, illusion of concurrency. Remember Jeff talked a lot about that before. Strictly speaking, if we only have one CPU, we're not doing more than one thing at a time. But it appears to be more than one thing at a time because why? We're doing a lot of things really, really quickly. It's kind of like the movie Illusion on this. So one problem with that is that since we do have a lot of things running and they're kind of being jiggled and jaggled amongst themselves, we have to deal with synchronization on this. So this is kind of one of the downsides to the whole threading model. We'll be alluding to this at the end of the class here. Threading is great in the sense that we've got the illusion of concurrency, and now with multiple CPUs, we even have real symmetric multiprocessing on this, but it makes it a pain to program. That's what you're dealing with right now in OS 161. Kernel programming is a lot harder because we've got these things, got block locks and spin locks, avoiding deadlocks and all that fun stuff on this. So we have to coordinate this mess here. Okay, last bullet point here. Now, we stop a thread, and then we know we're going to start it later on. And we basically want to move from one thing to the next thing, but then we want to move back to the first thing at a later point in time. So how do we want to make it appear that nothing has actually happened? Again, this is back to the analogy of, remember, poor Han Solo was frozen in carbonite. Okay, hopefully when Han Solo gets woken up again, Han will kind of think that it's the same time and day, if you will, at the point that the actual freezing took place. That's what we want to happen there. And how can we actually do that? We want to make sure that this thread, if you will, gets restored back to its original state. So, thread state, again, registers and stack, those are, if you will, the two main components to any thread or execution context. And again, this is one of the things that runs on the CPU. Now, I should say, There is also some additional administrative goo that goes with a thread to maintain its state, and you can actually yourselves take a look at some of that goo. Pull up the definition of thread struct in OS 161. You can see there's a whole bunch of different fields in there, things like the thread state. Is it currently sleeping? Is it currently zombie? Is it currently runnable? Whatever it is on that. We need a whole bunch of this administrative fields, but for practical purposes, again, it's the registers and the stack. Think of registers, again, as being, if you will, honestly, they are really a type of local variables on this. This is kind of how this all blends together here. Let's say that you're just writing a regular program in Java on that, and you got a bunch of local variables. Remember, local variables never have to be synced because they're eventually saved on the stack. Well, again, this is kind of the same, if you will, can of worms here, because registers often are used to hold, actually, to the extent possible, we'd like them to hold local variables on this. So that's something that, if you will, we need to save on the stack. That's why we were talking about a trap frame. Okay? Remember, when we go from, we have an interrupt, we want to switch from one thread to another, we've got to save, if you will, the registers, the local variables, onto the stack, because again, the stack is where we, if you will, put local variables when they're not in registers, when we have too many of them, yada yada on this. I should also say to digress for a wee bit here, all right? We're talking about operating systems, and we're talking about, if you will, let's say, trapping into a kernel. Like, let's say your program calls sysread on that. So I want to kind of poke the kernel. I need to kind of ask for help from the kernel. You can think of it as a type of subroutine call on that. And in one sense, it really is, because I am calling what looks like a function. It does stuff, and then it returns to me with a return value on that. Right? And I have parameters that I have to populate on that. Well, it's very similar to, if you will, what goes on with respect to, let's say, if you're calling, you're running, if you will, routine foo, and you call bar, what happens on this? Well, inside this user context, you push another, if you will, stack frame onto the stack, go to the next subroutine, and if you remember, if you took 341, remember you have to save out some registers, other registers you can use for parameters and whatnot. So it's a good analogy, okay? It's not exact in the sense that when we're trapping into the kernel, we got to make sure that everything is restored, okay? Because we don't know what the user is going to be doing in between this and vice versa. In other words, we have to have this huge firewall between a kernel and a user space here. But again, the rough analogy is you can think of it as a type of subroutine call in terms of you are still saving registers and returning values on that. Okay, question, comment.
So when a context switch happens and you build out the trap frame to save the thread state, do you then take that trap frame data and load it onto that thread stack for use later? Like,
in other words, where do we save the trap frame?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, good question. That's what we talked about, I think it was like on Monday or so. In other words, where do we actually save the trap frame? Again, think of the trap frame as being, well, it's the actually it is the registers, okay? And especially let's say that we're doing a syscall, those registers contain the parameters on that. And like any, if you will, subroutine call, that gets crammed onto the stack, okay? But we cram a lot more onto the stack, okay? Now, one other thing I should mention is, why do we put it onto the stack? I think someone asked me that. Like, why couldn't we, let's say, simply save the trap frame onto the heap or whatever else? Well, again, think again of the subroutine model, partly because we could have nested traps in the same way we can have nested subroutine calls. In other words, I could, let's say, call sysread. That generates a trap, and I have to cram a trap frame onto the stack. While I'm in the middle of sysread, let's say I do a page fault because I'm trying to access memory on this. Bingo, that generates another page fault that gets crammed onto the stack because it's a type of subroutine call. Not really, it's kind of going on behind the scenes, but we go to our memory manager. And while I'm in the middle of my memory manager, if you will, servicing my page fault, a timer fires. Well, now a third, if you will, trap frame gets crammed onto the stack. And I kind of have to return back up, if you will, peel off these various, if you will, trap frames till I eventually return to the caller on that. So in other words, one reason why we use the stack is that, again, you can think of it as analogous to a subroutine, and we don't know how many levels we're going to have. And where do we put levels? That's one of the main purposes of the stack on that. The other thing, too, is that, remember, the stack is kind of private to a particular thread on this. If we cram the subroutine onto the heap, well, now we're going to have to coordinate, well, this is the trap frame for which particular thread, and we're going to have to kind of keep it separate from, if you will, other threads on that, and that just introduces Drew's coordination problems. Again, let's just stick it onto the stack. Answer your question?
Yeah, thank you.
There was a hand.
When you say stack, can you specify whether you mean kernel stack?
Thank you.
User side, just to let it like more clear.
Good catch. Okay. Basically, when you have an interrupt, and let's say you are in user space, and you take a trap, that trap frame is put onto the kernel stack. Right? There was a question about that last time. Quick version is because we want to make sure that our context switch stuff, if you will, is not polluted. We have control over the kernel stack, et cetera, on this. So actually, if you want, it's a bit of a digression from your projects, but it really does help at a low level to understand what's going on with this. Look at kind of how the thread subsystem works, and that explains a lot about that. So nutshell version, if you are in user space and a trap happens, that trap frame gets crammed onto the kernel stack, et cetera, on this. And then obviously, while you're in kernel space, if there's another trap, yet another trap frame gets crammed onto the kernel stack on that too. So, other questions? Yes?
So user thread stack space will never actually get the trap frames pushed out of them in user space?
Almost. Essentially, no, okay. If we're talking about signal handling, but for practical
purposes.
Right, yeah, okay. So, and that actually, by the way, since we do save a trap frame onto the user space, now we have some security and sanitization issues, but essentially, no, that is correct. Yes. Mm-hmm. All righty. There we go. Okay. Now, context switches are good and bad. One of the nice things is when, let's say, we're going from user space to kernel space, or from, let's say, one kernel thread into another kernel thread or what have you. Oh, and by the way, again, I should be very clear. I'm glossing over there are trap frames and there are also switch frames. So if you see some code in OS 161 about that, I think I mentioned that the last time, the switch frame is actually when the context switch happens itself. So just make a mental note of that right now. They're not quite the same thing. But back to context switches on this here. One of the upsides to context switches is the reason we save all this stuff is we have a pure, unadulterated version of, if you will, a thread state. That's why we save all this stuff. We save a lot more registers than we would if we're, let's say, doing a simple subroutine call from user space to user space on this, because we need to make sure everything gets saved and restored kind of in toto on that. That is great for security, that's great for stability on this, but again, we're saving an awful lot of junk on this here. So what Jeff is trying to get at here is these context switches, they ain't free. Simply put, they take a lot of time, and well, wait a minute here. I guess there's two ways of doing this here. How could we possibly, let's say each thread context switch takes a lot of time, so I want to minimize that. One thing I could do is, let's say, lengthen the time between context switches, right? So let's say instead of the timer tick firing at 100 times a second, I have the timer tick fire 2 times a second. That is going to greatly decrease the overhead of a context switch at the downside of what now? If I have the timer tick every only twice a second, it's going to be, and definitely we're going to have some inefficiency, right? Because you're going to have a lot of cases of, okay, I finished up a calculation, I'm now waiting, and I have to kind of, well, wait a minute here. That's a good question here. Let's say that I'm doing some calculations, and I now need to wait on some data for a disk. Do I need to wait for that? Why am I hesitating? Because what am I going to do? Well, I could do busy waiting, but I want information from the disk. How do I get information from the disk? Syscall. So I'm going to, if you will, request syscall. That's going to trap into the kernel right then. So in other words, I don't have to wait for the timer tick on that. So in that particular case, I get lucky. The kernel will put me to sleep. All right. But there might still be another problem with that. How about you people? You are playing, what is the latest version that I'm Duke Nukem, I'm really dating myself. Or whatever it happens to be, Castle Wolfenstein, even worse. All right, let's say that you are playing a first-person shooter and you have context switches twice a second. Problems? Why did I pick something like that? Lag, yeah, okay. In other words, we've got probably a bunch of stuff going on and we need, again, remember the movie illusion here? There's a reason why, I think it was Thomas Edison picked 24 frames a second. It was kind of the slowest speed at the time that they could manage with the really old mechanical devices that was at least fast enough to maintain the illusion of motion to the human brain. So in other words, if we have, let's say, only twice a second, it's going to appear really choppy to you, the user interface on this. So we want it faster than that. My point is, there's a trade-off here. We don't want to go too fast, because now all we're going to be doing is doing what? If I have a 1 gigahertz processor, and I have the timer tick 1 billion times a second, what am I doing? Right. That's all I'm doing is servicing timer ticks. All right. In fact, I probably can't even keep up with that. So I'm going to have to kind of adjust the rate at firing on this. So far, so good? Make sense? Okay. This, by the way, is the sort of thing that Jeff is going to be asking you to kind of digest when it comes time to the test here. In other words, the trade-offs, the pros and cons of some of these policies. All right. Wait a minute. There we go. Oh, just general questions? Comments, complaints? No hands. Okay. Threads. Okay, we talked. There we go. Okay. Thread, if you will, the thread context registers and stacks here. Now let's talk a little bit about what gets shared, threads and processes. All right. And again, what is a process? Roughly speaking, it is a bunch of threads that share the same user thingamajig context on this. And one thing that you can ask yourself is, remember fork and remember Jeff's discussion about fork? What does sysfork duplicate when I want to, if you will, duplicate a process? Does it duplicate the registers or the stack? Can you talk about that? Interesting. What are registers and stack? Okay, they are, if you will, part of the thread state, right? So let's think about this for just a little bit. Well, maybe go down to the bottom here. Does the memory get duplicated in fork? Okay, the address space gets duplicated. So in other words, what is shared between threads? Memory. So if we have one process that has two threads, they get to share the same address space. Similarly, remember, fork duplicates the file descriptor table? Same thing. In other words, the threads in a particular process get to share, if you will, a file table on this. So kind of bubble back up to the top here. We duplicated these things here. Did we duplicate the registers and the stack? A thread, it's an execution context. If I duplicate an execution context, I now have two threads that are doing what? The same thing, right? That defeats the purpose of having multiple threads on here. So in other words, we want to have multiple threads within a process, but they're going to be doing different things. So that's kind of a thread stack does not get duplicated, if you will, let's say a call to sysfork. As a matter of fact, well, it's kind of like this. You call thread fork, right? But what does thread fork do? It creates a new thread, if you will, okay? Because if we have one process and one thread, we have to start the child process off. That's a clone of, if you will, the original process. Make sense on this? But if I have one process and I have, let's say, multiple threads within that process, it makes absolutely no sense for the threads to be doing the same thing. Because the whole point of multiple threads within the same process is they're doing different things. But again, just to clarify again, when we do call sysfork, at least initially we want the threads within the process to be doing at least apparently the same thing. Questions on this? Yes.
So when a process calls sysfork, calling threads, registers, and stack,
Yes and no. It's kind of like this, since we're starting, or if you will, we're returning to user space, if you will. Like, if you take a look at an OS 161, okay, when what we really care about is returning to the point in user space that sysfork was called, all right? And what OS 161 actually does is, when you go back into user space, it resets the stack pointer at the top. So, in essence, like, a thread can never really return to where it was before it trapped into user space. That's why I was mentioning earlier, you can think of user space calling, let's say, a kernel syscall as a subroutine on that. Does that make sense? So, in other words, we, whatever our thread context was, we really don't care because we're going into user space, and when we come back from user space, we're in essence going to have kind of a clean stack. Okay, that is the specific OS 161 implementation of that. Other questions? Yes. You know what? I do not know the exact numbers on this. I know you can actually funk around with it with OS 161. I think it was at like 25 megahertz, but again, that's an emulated system on that. Wait a minute. No, that's actually the clock frequency on that. So, but you got me on that. I really do not know. It's going to be, I know, faster than the usual human perceptual limit and slower than whatever the clock frequency of the processor is. I gave myself really wide bounds on that one. Other questions that I can try to answer? And you know what, I should also say this, that's something that you can dynamically change too, depending upon what's going on. Alrighty. This is a nifty little, there we go. Okay, this is a nice little diagram here, and what we're trying to do is, initially we have a process, actually two processes, and what does that process consist of? Well, we have this address space. Remember our different, if you will, address segments. You'll be toying around with those in assignment 3. We got our file table with our handles that are pointing to open files. And as of right now, we just have one thread. We can add more threads to this. Again, for the purposes of OS 161, you're not responsible for implementing multiple threads. If you want to, go right ahead. That is part of assignment number 7. All right, that is due on August 15th. So aside from that, though, right now, this is kind of the model that you're dealing with in OS 161, and it did certainly represent the model of, if you will, historic operating systems before they kind of decide to get funky with multiple threads. Okay, why do we want to use these threads here? Well, again, part of it goes back to the historicity of, remember, batch processing was inefficient. So we need to kind of use that CPU, schedule other things. Plus, we have this whole thing about illusion of concurrency here. But there's another thing from kind of, if you will, a philosophical aspect here. Especially take a look at number 2 here. Sometimes it's a good way about thinking about things or conceptualizing the problem at hand that you're trying to sell. Sometimes you have a problem that can kind of easily be divided up into 2 parts, and so you know what, we're going to stick different threads on them. An example or 2 of that in just a little bit. Number 3 here, we've already talked about that a lot here, namely put, if we've got, if you will, delays, okay, let's say the disk drive is holding back the CPU, well, let's not hold back the CPU. We'll schedule the CPU to do something else on this. Okay, there we go. Kitchen analogy on this. Okay, the kitchen is the process, and the cooks, roughly speaking, are the thread. So they have their own address space, in this case, the room on here. Okay, and within a particular process, you know what, they're doing related but somewhat different things here. So they're all preparing food, ideally. Let's say maybe you've got the pastry chef, you've got the, who knows, the entree chef, and they're all preparing, let's say, something for one particular meal here. But again, they are doing different things at different times here. The last part here bears, if you will, mentioning here. They have a private state, but they can communicate easily here. So what we're talking about is that because they share, if you will, the same address space, even though they have individual stacks, they can still pass data back and forth between each other very quickly. In other words, the pastry chef can yell at the entree chef to shake a leg if things are, if you will, going too slowly or what have you. They're standing probably right across the room from each other on that. right. Oh, that's must coordinate. Oh, coordinate, what we're also talking about that is synchronization. In other words, ideally, we want to make sure that the dessert comes out not before the entree, okay, but not too long after. So again, this is timing, coordination, communication on this. That was correct. Oh, this did not show up on my computer. I was wondering what happened to that meme. Okay. I just got a completely white screen when I was preparing for this lesson. So, okay, that is the meme. Okay. Ah, philosophical way of looking at things, okay? Threads versus events on this. Now, ultimately, on most operating systems, things are implemented with threads, but that's not necessarily the best way of always thinking about things. Sometimes there are better ways of engineering things, of designing things on that, and events is a good example of that. If you think about it, let's talk about you got a GUI, and remember back to, let's say, 115, 116, you got all these buttons on the screen for whatever game it was that Carl Alphonse had you doing that particular project. And each button is going to be linked up to some sort of an event handler or an event servicer on this. I really don't care about the threading abstractions that are going on in the background. What I care about is, if this button is clicked on, how do I handle that event on that? And just, you know what, as far as I'm concerned, it's I write code that will service that event, and then as far as I'm concerned, it just runs to completion. What's going on with the threading subsystem? It's, you know what, it's something that I really just don't want to think about on this. As opposed to, if I take a threading model, I'm probably going to be much more explicit about things like synchronization, blocking. Sometimes that's good, sometimes that's bad on that. So again, it depends what you're doing and kind of what your approach is on that. Okay. Naturally threaded multi-applications. Here we go here. Things like web server. In other words, let's say that you go to, who knows, foo.com, and foo.com, let's say you're trying to request a whole bunch of, who knows, let's say JavaScript snippets and JPEGs, GIFs, GIFs, what have you on that. And in effect, what the web server is going to try to do is send you a whole bunch of snippets over the web. So it's going to, you know what, have a whole bunch of worker threads to send you each one of these individual things. So it's part of, if you will, the web server's process, but you know what, while one thread is grabbing one graphic, another thread is grabbing another graphic, it'll kind of speed things up from the web server's standpoint on this. Because I've got a request for 10 items, so rather than servicing them ad seriatim, I'm going to have 10 threads work on them simultaneously. Okay, that's what we mean by something that lends itself easily to multi-threading on this. Similarly, on the browser end here, you have different tabs within the same application. Well, that application is a process, so we want, let's say, Firefox, Chrome, what have you, to communicate within itself about its state here. But within that state here, you know, these particular threads here, one is at foo.com, another one is at bar.com, and they're doing different things here. So we want different threads running that. Scientific or like big data crunching on this here. All right, that's kind of what Jeff's research lab does, is like a lot of data processing for, if you will, data from smartphones. And we have a test bed of 100-ish or so phones that are out there, and we get these big blobs of data here. And periodically, I and others have to go through and crunch lots of data. Well, you know what? What we need to do is, we've got data that we've collected from 100 phones. Let's crunch the data from phone 1, from phone 2, from phone 3, what have you. That's something that is what we like to call embarrassingly parallelizable. If we want simply to, if you will, see what happens on each of these phones, we can handle them as individual threads. Make sense on this? My point being is, sometimes things like buttons on a GUI are easier to visualize and code for in terms of events. Other things like, let's say, servicing web requests or crunching data among mutually independent, let's say, sources of data, those are better to think about in terms of threads. With the caveat that, under the hood, I should say this, event-driven programming still is implemented with threads. Hence, if you look at, remember in Java, there's this thing called, quote, event dispatch thread, EDT. But that's another story. All right, why not processes? We're talking about, again, on this last one here, we can, let's say, use threads to, let's say, handle tabs or threads to parallelize stuff or what have you. All right, that's great. So why don't we, let's say, use embarrassingly parallelizable processes, just fork off a whole bunch of independent processes? Well, in theory, you could do this. So in other words, it's not so much that we can't do it in principle, but we get into, if you will, some, if you will, what's the word I'm fishing for? Like time and performance issues on this. Because what's the whole point of a thread? Or I'm sorry, thread versus a process? A process is a bunch of threads that share the same, among other things, memory space. It's easy. Remember, the pastry chef can shout at the entree chef because they're right in the same room on that. As opposed to a different process, let's say the kitchen didn't receive its order, you're going to have to pick up a phone and call a supplier. That's going to be, if you will, more overhead. It's going to be more costly, more delays on that. Because remember, one of the biggest things of modern operating systems, multiplexing, security, process isolation. All right, threads trust each other. So maybe make a note of this mentally on paper, what have you. But threads within a process trust each other. Processes, even if they want to trust each other, are not allowed to trust each other, and the kernel enforces that with very good reason on this. All right, stability, security, what have you on this. I mean, think about Timberlake on that. That has processes running from multiple different users on that. Do you want, say user X to have access to your address space? No, you do not. Hence the concept of process isolation on this. So the thing is, this is great for security and stability, but IPC, inter-process communication, is more difficult because we have to have all these firewalls in place, and the kernel has to enforce this. So it adds overhead. Yes, we can do inter-process communication. Again, anything we can do with threads, we can do with processes, but it's going to be, in general, much slower, much more inefficient on that. If you've ever programmed in Python and you've had to deal with the GIL, the global interpreter lock, you know what I'm talking about, because there is essentially a bug in Python that you can't easily use threads at the same time. So you have to use processes, and it's one of these holy wars that it is what it is on that. All right. Questions, comments, complaints? So far what we've talked about is threads versus processes, why sometimes threads are better, what the advantages of processes are, different ways of thinking about things, event-driven versus, if will, a threading view of the model. Moving right along. Okay, implementing threads. Okay. Here we are. Okay, well, we already have, there's a couple ways of doing this. Down at the bottom here is essentially what we've already been talking about. Threads implemented through the kernel directly, the one-to-one threading model. In other words, I am in a process and I call the pthread library to fork off another worker thread. The kernel handles creating the thread, scheduling the thread, yada, yada, yada on that. So again, this is the same diagram that we had before. We've got our process, same address space, same file table, but again, now we have three threads that are managed by the kernel. That's one way of approaching things. Go back up to the top here, the M-to-1 threading model. What that's talking about is, rather than the process calling a pthread library, well, you know what? Let's just say the process has one and only one thread. Again, this goes back to the historic model here. We're just going to kind of do our own management of threads on this. In other words, you know what? I know what I need to do, and I know I need to do a bunch of mathematical calculations. I also need to fetch stuff from the disk on that. So you know what? I'm going to kind of time things to make sure that I don't ever waste time. Okay, if I'm waiting for information from the disk, well, maybe I'll kind of try to arrange that and then maybe do something else in the meantime. Or, in other words, basically, I am going to somehow, I'm one thread within one process, and while I'm in the user context, I'm going to kind of subdivide within myself, if you will, user-level threads on this. There's pros and cons to that, as you can imagine, on this too. And let's look at them here. Okay, here we go. Here we are. First off, take a look at this. Multiplexing, and anything that involves multiplexing and security, a lot more overhead on this. So one thing I can do is, since I'm in user land, I can, instead of dealing with things like multiplexing, and kernel-level context switching, I can deal with stuff like, take a look at this. We have these routines like set jump and long jump. Right? In other words, I can use user-level routines to, if you will, switch from one thread to another. So I don't have to save out all those registers because I trust myself on this. All right, preempting other threads on this here. Well, there's a couple things. One way is I can be nice to myself. This is the old, goes back to old versions of Windows, if you will, cooperative multitasking, where threads are counting on each other to periodically yield. Or you can maybe ask for a little bit of help here and ask for, let's say, a signal or something else like that. It's not quite as, if you will, overhead heavy as a periodic timer tick for multiple kernel managed threads here. But the upshot is I can still kind of implement threads in user space, and it's going to be a lot less overhead on that. This is, an example of how we can, for example, affect a type of context switch in user space. And Jeff has written up a little bit of a nugget here that illustrates, let's say, the set jump, long jump routines here. And TLDR on this, I'm going through a loop, I'm iterating 10 times, well, almost. I get to 0.5 here, and that at 0.5 here, what do I do here is I break out of the loop, and then I drop down here. Okay, so you can see what's going to happen is I'm going to say value of, 0 through up until 5, and then I'm going to break. And then take a look at what's happened. I go down here, and then let's say something else happens. And then later on, I run this command down here, long jump. And basically, what that does is it takes me back to kind of where I was, and I can continue on this. See what's going on? So I'm in user space. Okay, I went through half of my loop, and then in effect, I have kind of like a programmed or self-implemented save of my context. And then later on, I want to kind of restore back to this. And what are we actually going to print out on this? Let's take a look here. Up to 5, I hit my saved state, I break out, and then guess what? I restore, and then I print out the remainder of the loop. Nice. So that's kind of user-level implementation of how I can save and restore state. No context switches needed on that. Much less overhead. All right. Oh. Again, this did not show up on my, I can't say an XP machine because I had it in Ubuntu mode. But the upshot is, we nailed a long jump. So, forgot the set jump. Here we are. Pros and cons, again, of user space here. Pros is essentially the threads can be smaller and much faster. We're already talking about that. Now, essentially, though, we're losing something in terms of the kernel, which means we lose the overhead on this, and among other things here. Well, this is kind of interesting. We can't use multiple cores because why? Remember, I've got one process and one thread, and that thread here is operating within a user context here. That thread is set to run on, let's say, core number 0 by the kernel. I, as a user, can't say, I want another thread to run on another core. I need help from the kernel to do that. As a matter of fact, it's also going to be, even if I do get that amount of help from the kernel, I'm going to still have to worry about coordinating among different threads at this point. So essentially, I'm kind of limited to the model of, if you will, one user thread as essentially running on apparently one core on that. So I'm kind of giving up a little bit of resources on this. Another thing too here is operating system can't schedule the application. Essentially, second put here, the operating system, if you will, knows more about the system as a whole, right? But if you will, the operating system knows less about what's going on within a particular process or a thread. So this can be kind of viewed as two sides of the ball bearing here. So, essentially put, if you will, if I have user space managed threads, that, if you will, process hopefully is going to be able to do a better job of scheduling the thread within itself, but it's going to have a much poorer view of the system overall on that. Another thing too is, since, again, I don't have these multiple cores and I have much less control over, if you will, scheduling on this, if I block, let's say, I'm my one kernel level thread that appears to be multiple user level threads, and I'll say I call sysread. Well, guess what? I'm suspended, as are all the other user created threads on this too. So again, I'm not getting any work done. So it's more efficient, but it's also less efficient. Make sense on this? Okay. This is the sort of thing that makes another good exam question. Alrighty. There we go. Oh, pros again. And this is kind of the mirror opposite of that, if you will. Okay, the kernel has a better, if you will, view of the entire system on this, and it can schedule among different cores here. But again, we have, if you will, the cons of, if you will, the, if you will, the context switch overhead. All right. Oh, thread scheduling here, yes. Policies. This is going to be where we're getting into, like, how fast should we run the timer tick, okay? In what order should we, if you will, run which, if you will, threads or processes on this. That's actually critically important to user experience. It's critically important to system efficiency on that, too. And if you look at things like the OS 161 really does not have much in the way of policies. It's a didactic operating system, and the purpose is to implement base functionality on this, all right? In a real operating system, you are going to see lots and lots of code devoted to things like optimization, detecting current user state, like it has the current, let's say the user been blocking on a certain type of IO, or is there a particular tweak we can kind of effectuate to, let's say, giving more memory to one process, or let's say adjusting more clock cycles to a particular process that might optimize things on that. And again, here's where you can get into a lot of AI and different algorithms, but again, that's something that we do for the most part gloss over in OS 161. So if you're looking for a lot of that optimization code, you're not going to see much of it, if any of it. Questions on this? Yes.
When we implement user level threads, do we have to implement our own scheduler, or does the C system library provide that?
Good point here. In other words, how do we even have a scheduler in the first place? So this is one thing. The question is, how do we implement a scheduler if we do have user-level threads? I guess there's two parts to that, is how do we actually get to the scheduler? So we have to deal with, we don't have a kernel-enforced timer tick. We either have to have, let's say, a thread yield, or we have to, let's say, ask the kernel for help with maybe some like signal or something like that that we talked about. But the other thing is, yes, we now have to have our own internal scheduling algorithm. Because let's say I am one process with one kernel-level thread, and I have subdivided that kernel-level thread up into 10 user-managed threads. In what order and how much time they get? Yes, that is exactly code that I'm going to have in my own user space. So again, and here you can argue, well, that user space can probably tweak itself better, but it's still going to be blind vis-a-vis the rest of the system. Answer your question?
Yep.
Other questions? Okay, that's just about it. I will stick around as thank you very much for coming. I'm glad to see that you have held it right through to the end. See you next week. Well, actually, Jeff will see you next week. 5 p.m., checkpoint 2.1. Take care, people.